Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadro, the Director of Portfolio Management at TRICOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is John Klimshin. John is known to clients and fans as Coach K. He has been an architect for growth for teams and individuals in the arenas of executive communication, inspirational language, and practical skills ranging from perennial sales mentality to thought processes. John is either traveling the world speaking about deeper dialogue, moving conversations forward, or mindful leadership, or coaching executives, writing, and podcasting. He has written 12 books, the topics of which have evolved over the years from addressing and exploring creativity to executive development and scaling teams. John narrates his own audiobooks, the most recent of which is Breaking All Records, Deeper Dialogue, Conversations That Inspire, as the work speaks to people in a myriad of roles. In today's Industry Insider webinar, our author, speaker, and coach, John, will share the key phrases and concepts from his new audiobook, Deeper Dialogue, Conversations That Inspire. He describes the session in this way. This journey began with the concept of the stunning alchemy of solid language. The first time he stated that as an intent, it was responded to by a live audience of executives who ran an $8 billion organization. These were experienced leaders who prided themselves in the humanity of their approach to leadership. He took the concept and wrote an article. Then he spoke about it, workshop material for months, and then built the framework for Deeper Dialogue. And almost 2 years later, the book and the audio project, Deeper Dialogue, Conversations That Inspired, was completed. So we hope that this speaks to you today. By the end of the session, you'll gain a greater understanding of how to identify and engage in deeper dialogue. If you have questions during the presentation, please utilize the chat or the Q&A feature so that we can answer any questions that you have and take time throughout the presentation to have some dialogue. We'll also open the floor for some questions at the very end as well. And with that, I will turn the floor over to John.
Amanda, thanks a million. And wow, when I hear that that whole story told again of the genesis of this idea, the concept, and then it moving into something that turned into an audiobook, I'm reminded of the journeys that all of us embark on, the intellectual journeys, the emotional journeys, the life journeys. And that's really what this is about. It is when I was going back and forth and brainstorming with a good friend of mine who is an accomplished screenwriter, we crafted the title together, and Michael ended up being gracious enough to write the foreword for the audiobook Deeper Dialogue. Now, I made the choice to create an audiobook for a reason, because this is all about language. Over the course of the time that we will spend together today, wherever you are, whatever you're doing, whatever you're thinking about or whatever you're focusing on, it is all driven by language. And we're going to talk about the power of language and how we can leverage that power more often and more consistently. In addition to that, today is about another territory that we can explore together as part of this journey. And when we came up with the title Deeper Dialogue, we went back and forth with, well, what is the subtitle or the follow-up to that? How do we help people understand what deeper dialogue is all about? How do I know if I'm even in dialogue, much less deeper dialogue? Well, there are a couple of indicators. There are a couple of road signs that we will identify over our time together. There, we will walk through a PowerPoint presentation that you will find is more about imagery and simple statements than it is about a bunch of text that I will read to you. And the imagery has been very carefully curated, and the text that I will read, you know, and kind of jump off of has been very carefully constructed. So deeper dialogue. First and foremost, those of you that are looking at the screen, I want to apologize for me not catching the double L in the middle of dialogue. And it occurred to me that if anyone on this webinar listening in, if any of you are in sales, then of course I can, you know, I can make the excuse that I was trying to make a subtle hint that you should pick up the phone again soon, but we'll talk about that more in detail later. What is deeper dialogue? Well, it's about conversations that inspire. Think about the most recent conversation you had that walking away from that conversation, you felt inspired. Inspiration is absolutely a firing of mental synapse, in addition to it creating a glow around our heart that is unmistakable, that is undeniable. And inspiration is very different from our motivation. And I'll talk about that in a little bit more detail in a moment. So deeper dialogue, conversations that inspire, this is about how we engage and involve and connect with human beings. Everyone in the business world, even if you spend a tremendous amount of time staring at a screen, accomplishing your work, making your contribution, all of us will eventually engage in conversations and be required to figure out how to connect with humans. And the word connect has a bunch of different resonances for me. As I now have a mild panic attack because I cannot get the slide advance piece of this to work. Amanda, I wonder if you can help. Ah, there it is. All right, now we got it. Nothing like mastering the technology before you start to use it. So the word is connect. When you feel connected to someone, certain things are understood between you. When you connect with someone, you share an electricity that you don't with the people that you just walk by and don't have connections with. And the reason I love the word connect is because it shares the same root. It shares the first two letters with other words that are as important and that will help us to find ways to connect. We don't connect with people because we choose to. We connect with people because we find common ground, because we hear things that they say or hear things in their voice or pick things up about them that make us curious, that make us want to return to the conversation or to continue the conversation. And we will talk about conversation in a minute. And isn't it convenient? Isn't it funny? Isn't it odd that conversation starts with C-O as well? Connect, conversation, communicate, contribute, collaborate. All of these start with CO. And in the audiobook Deeper Dialogue, I started talking about why I made the choice to do an audiobook, because I wanted people to listen to it at what a friend of mine calls the speed of self. Whenever you are completely undistracted, whenever you are in motion, whether you're traveling, whether you're commuting, whether you're going on a hike, and it is up to you at what pace and what the ultimate destination is, that's traveling at the speed of self. And when we do that, we tend to tune out a lot of the noise in our lives. You know, Amanda and I were talking just a few minutes before we went live on this, and we were talking about how important it is to connect with people and to be able to engage in meaningful conversations. And the good news to me is that I've been teaching this as a concept for some time, and the more we experience and watch the growth and the impact of social media, the more convinced I am that this material and these ideas are critical to the health and the growth of all of us as professionals and as people. So if we are interested in connecting with other humans, we have to be able to communicate. Now, my definition, I'm a word geek. I'm a language fanatic. If you were to come into my office and look at my bookshelf, you would see a variety of different sources, resources, texts, and commentaries on everything from the power of myth to the unfolding of language. everything from how the mind works to Proust was a neuroscientist. And I bring these up because what we read shapes how we think. And if we want to shape how we think about one of the single most incredible and powerful tools at our disposal from the moment we wake up, then we need to have an understanding of and appreciation for how powerful language is. Years ago, I had an epiphany, and I don't remember the moment. I remember the feeling. I remember the transaction, and I remember how inspired I was to start exploring this. And the epiphany that I had was that language at its core is music. If you think about the way that we discuss language, the way things are phrased, how they make us feel, the tone, tenor, tempo, and rhythm of the way someone speaks helps us to identify how they think, how they view the world. Language at its core is music. And if you think about it, every language on earth has its own tonality, has its own cadence, and different people have different tonalities and cadence within those languages, and that's where we get something called a dialect. And if language at its core is music, that means that we need to view language the same way an architect would view the study of architecture, the same way a musician would study the basics and the core or the structure of music. Now, I've been a musician for many, many years. And throughout my studies, throughout the instruments that I have adopted and struggled with over the years, I have found that each individual instrument has its own tonality, tempo, cadence, all that stuff, and it also has its own personality. When we think about language being music, that brings me to what Amanda quoted in that introduction, which is the statement, the stunning alchemy of solid language. When we can express an idea, a concept, a hope, an emotion, when we can express it in the least amount of language, that means that we have whittled it down, we have sculpted our statement through the lens of, I want the message to be clear. And one thing that gets in the way of clarity is additional words. When we listen to interviews or read interviews with musicians, specifically lead guitarists in the rock world, or even soloists in jazz, they will continually talk about the space in between the notes. They will continually focus on the pauses because of how much power is found in silence. Now, language at its core is music. That, to me, again, it means that we have tone, tenor, tempo, rhythm, tonality, intonation. We have dynamics. We have emotion. And if you are in a leadership role, if you are in a sales role, if you are in a service role, then language is your stock in trade. If it's your stock in trade, it's important that you understand how it works so that you can leverage it, use it, deploy it so that it will serve you better. And another thing that occurred to me when I started exploring all of the language that I've created and written about and spoken about over the years about language at its core is music, it also occurs to me that when we hear the sound of someone's voice who we care deeply about, it immediately tugs at our hearts. When we hear a song that has particular resonance for us because it brings us back to a moment, that tugs at our hearts. And I believe it was the poet Maya Angelou who said, people may not remember precisely what you say, but they will remember how what you say made them feel. Now, we can get into a debate about whether or not we can make people feel stuff. That's not the issue. Everyone has a visceral response. Many of us have deeply emotional responses to music and to language. if you're a music fan. There's music you love. There's music you're not so fond of. If you're not a music fan, you would prefer that it's not playing in every restaurant that you walk into, and I understand that. We live in a loud society. We live in an over-communicated society. So how do we refine it, and how do we deploy it in a way where language is going to serve us? And the only way it's going to serve us is if we serve it by understanding the basics, the components, the absolute critical foundational bricks that make up what language is all about. If you know anything about music, you know that in order to improvise, you've got to have a pretty solid understanding of your instrument. You have to be comfortable in that key, in that genre, in that time, and in that space. Because pausing creates silence, and we're going to talk about silence in just a couple of minutes. So the key for this slide and the key for this section of our time together is that language at its core is music. What does that mean? That means that I can craft it in my mind before I allow it to come out of my mouth, which means that the more succinct my language is, the clearer my message is. Those of you that are fans of the television show Shark Tank, however you may feel about Mark Cuban, he said something on one of the shows that, of course, got the attention of the person pitching, but it also made everyone around him nod. He said, listen, the longer the backstory, the more I doubt the success of the business. In other words, if you have to tell me 17 things before I can understand the key concept you're trying to get across to me, I'm not sure we're communicating. If you have to express an idea in 17 sentences in an email, that's a little lengthy. That is quite a demand on the reader. So in language, I'm not saying we should be in a hurry, and I'm not saying we should be as brief as possible. What I'm saying is, once you have communicated the idea, then
John,
you're
are you
done.
There?
I am here.
Okay, sorry, we lost you for just a second.
Okay, when?
If you could just replay like the last maybe 5 seconds. It was just the end of that sentence we missed.
Okay, I'm not, it's about being, not about hurrying up, but, if it takes you 17 sentences to get an idea across, that's quite a demand on the reader. If it takes you 20 minutes to explain an idea, or to give all of the backstory so that someone will agree with you when you ask them their opinion, yes. Hello?
A second there. Hello, are you there?
I'm here. Can you hear me now?
Okay. I can hear you now.
All right. I feel bad. I'm not sure why it keeps getting interrupted. But I'll...
Yeah, it just did that. Yeah. So go ahead and get back to it. I'll pop in if I have any trouble hearing it.
Okay. All right, folks. So let's go to the next slide. So now... I'm going to move back because I don't want us focusing on that right now. One of the ways that I have found to help folks start to come to conclusions, start to understand where I want their mind to go, is to make comparisons between two key concepts. And I would like everyone that's listening to make the comparison in their mind between power and force. Now, if you have commentary, of course, throw it into the chat. Power and force are distinct. They are different. They must be thought of and addressed when we come to the essentials of deeper dialogue. And the reason is that power is attractive. Force is repellent. If you've ever been around someone who you perceive to be powerful, you may describe that person as calm, centered, confident, clear in their language, maybe even quiet. And when I say that power is attractive, I'm talking about us operating, selling, leading, communicating, maintaining relationships. All of these are part of the same, in my mind, all of those are part of the same continuum. Selling, leading, maintaining relationships, dealing with humans, they're all part of the same continuum. And when we operate from a position of power, where we do not appear to be in a hurry, we hear people out, and we are more than happy to share or distribute that power with others, because the more I share that power, the more I can enjoy it, embody it, and be part of it. It doesn't dissipate when it's given away. Force, we all have a visceral, mental, emotional, physiological response to when someone is looking to force an issue, force an idea, force a decision. And again, all of this relates to selling, leading, maintaining relationships, because force is repellent. Force is an outside idea that is designed to get me to come to some conclusion, whether I like it or not. Whereas power maintains that, look, this is where we are, this is how we operate, this is what we do, we're inviting you to be part of this. So when we compare and contrast these two concepts, we're thinking about not only how the mind works, but how language works, and how language is received, and how it's processed, so that we can operate from a position of power, and we can accomplish something really, really exciting. I said earlier that there's a certain level of resonance when we speak to people, and I will never forget the first night of a creative writing course that I took many, many years ago. It was led by a professor named Charles Hood, and he got up in front of the class and waited for everything to calm down and for it to become quiet, which that is a demonstration of power. He did not ask people to be quiet. He didn't clear his throat. He didn't make a loud noise. He stood and waited. And once all of the adults in this class realized that it was time for him to speak, he said something incredibly powerful. He said, and it was, again, it was a creative writing class. He said, the first thing he said was, great writing has resonance. That is one of the most beautifully constructed sentences I have ever heard. That's why I memorized it. We're talking more than 20 years ago when I was in the room with that gentleman. I've gone back to him when I've had books that were about to be published, and I asked him for notes and that sort of thing. It's been a fun and informative relationship for me. Think about any book you've read, article you've read, anything you've heard someone say where it resonated with you. That is an indication of great writing. And we are writing all the time. You don't have to consider yourself a writer to think about how you communicate. Yes?
Oh, sorry. You said we write all the time, and then I think we lost you.
Okay. Well, I paused for a second, but I'll try to get that back. I'm sorry that this keeps happening, folks. I'm not sure why. But we'll go on as if nothing happened. So great writing has resonance. And that has deep meaning for me, because when we can craft language, written or spoken, because we are all, what I was saying was we are all writing all the time. Everyone listening to this right now, you're either totally in it and taking notes and you're writing, or you're half in and half out, and that's okay because you're writing what you're going to say when this is over. When you head home today, you're going to be writing in your head what you hope your next conversations will include. We're always writing. We're always crafting. So all the more reason for us to carefully craft language that will resonate. And resonate doesn't mean get people to do what we want. It means that it communicates. And to me, the definition of communication is the positive progressive exchange of ideas. Many of us have heard the words or said the words, we're really not connecting here. That doesn't feel like we're communicating here. Or even worse, we have heard the words, you're not listening to me. When we interrupt someone, we disengage from the electric transfer between the two of us. When we interrupt someone, we are telling them a whole myriad of things just by that action. even though what we feel wildly compelled to say next might be monumentally important, when you interrupt me, you're telling me through that act that you do not believe that what I have to say is important. Whether or not that's your intention is immaterial. This is how human relationships work. So how do we create resonance? Well, we have to craft language that we believe will resonate with the listener or the reader. And resonance is similar to, you know, you hear someone say something and say, oh, yeah, that's true. Other times you hear someone say something and you say, yeah, because, man, that applies to me. And yet other times you hear someone say something and you go, because that resonates, that means something to you right now in this moment at a deep level. What is deeper dialogue all about? Well, it's deeper than how's the weather. It's deeper than you want to go get a cup of coffee. It is deeper dialogue is about being able to craft, leverage, and deliver language that will move conversations forward. Everyone on earth, in every conversation they're in, is hoping that their conversations will move forward. Now, being a language geek, being a crafter of language for many, many years, through the books I've written, through the audio books that we've created, through the sessions that I conduct live all over this great world of ours, what I have found is that this sentence has innate power. And the power is that it begins with a verb, moving conversations forward, not trying to move conversations forward, not attempting to, not hoping to, doing it. It begins with a verb, which for language geeks, this means that this statement is what's called a present tense perfect. It is actionable because it indicates action, because it starts with a verb. So let's get out of the language geekdom and let's talk about the power of moving conversations forward. It is, notice the difference between getting conversations to move forward, making a conversation move forward, pushing a conversation forward. Moving conversations forward indicates what? Collaboration, connectivity, communication, connotation, and contribution. Conversations are between two people. You leaving me a voicemail is not a conversation. It may not even be a component of one. A conversation is something where I am engaged in the moment. I am present in the now, and you have my attention and vice versa. In moving conversations forward, in moving a conversation forward, what that means is that you're pointed toward a common future, pointed toward a future condition that is preferable. I love the word preferable. It's a lot like the word favorable, and both of them, they speak to me, they resonate with me because they are devoid of hard consonants. They are devoid of the CK sound, the T sound, the CH sound. They invite and engage the listener. This is the level of granularity that I think about language at, just so you know. Now, to give you some background, when I was very young, I was identified in school as someone that may have a talent for languages. I was given the opportunity a year before many other students. I wasn't the only one. There were several in my class at that time who were given the opportunity to start studying a foreign language other than English, which is what I'm talking about, at an early age. I was given the option of German, Italian, Spanish, or Russian. Now, you've seen my last name on the slides here. I am not of Russian descent. However, back when my family left the European continent, there was a connection to Russia. So I decided to study Russian. Since then, I have studied Spanish, Italian, French, and German. And what I've learned is that every language on earth has words for yes, no, please, thank you. What I've learned is that you cannot learn basic conversational in any language other than your own without getting a sense, without getting insight into the culture behind that language. Years ago, we were fortunate enough, my wife and I, to be able to take our, at that time, pre-teenage kids, two of them, a son and a daughter, over to Europe. We were going to go to France, and Germany. And I told both of the kids that they must learn on their own. I would give them the resources, but they needed to learn and to be able to demonstrate to me that they could say, yes, no, please, thank you. How much is this? And where is the bathroom, please? In the languages of the countries we were going to visit. Because it was imperative in my mind and in my heart that they would be accepted there and that they would have a better opportunity to communicate with people there as opposed to be an invisible tourist. Visiting host countries, to me, in my mind, this is my view, my philosophy, indicates that maybe we should learn a little bit of their language to show respect for the fact that we're visitors. And I will tell you that the welcome that we received, the interactions that my kids had with people there, with those simple things, and then apologizing that they didn't speak a better version or go deeper into conversation, only created positive experiences for us. So what does it mean to move a conversation forward? It means that we're not dragging, driving, forcing, or pushing. It means that it is just as much the other person's idea as our idea, and we are getting into a state of flow. We are getting into an arena where we feel relaxed and powerful at the same time. We are looking forward because that's physiologically, psychologically, that's the way we're designed. Every one of us is wondering, what are we going to do tomorrow, this weekend, next month? Where are we going on vacation this year? Who's going to be in the Super Bowl next year? Well, who will participate in the Olympics come this spring? We're all looking forward. And if we can move conversations forward, we can create the vision of a future that is collaborative and connected. And think about the way the human body is designed. The eyes are at the top of the head, and they are forward facing. Our feet point out in front of us. We're designed to want to go forward, to advance, and I believe to go deeper. So what that means to me is a couple of different things. One of them is that I'm pursuing mastery. And in medieval times, the only way to gain any skill or respect or to create a living in a skill, an art, or a technique was to go through three key development phases. One was apprentice, next was journeyman, and for a precious few was master. In order for us to pursue mastery, we have to understand the power of something that is at our disposal all day, every day. As long as we're awake, this tool is at our disposal. And this tool can make a huge difference in our ability to move conversations forward. And moving conversations forward occurs when we ask questions that are not self-serving nor self-focused. They are not self-serving nor are they self-focused, meaning that they're about the other person and the future. Questions like, what do you think we should do next? Where do you see this going from here? What would you like to see happen? And one of my favorites, what is the best way for us to move forward? Clear, focused language, present in the moment, operating from power, not forcing, creating a collaborative environment so that we connect is what mastery is all about. And it is a pursuit. You will never arrive. So what that means is that this is something we can invest a fair amount of time on and time in, and we can develop over time. And one of the key components, the key thing, is something that I referenced earlier. And I've employed several times in this presentation, and it's silence. True silence is exceedingly rare. Mental silence is almost impossible. And in a recent coaching conversation with someone, I said to them, silence is the exclusive territory of the powerful. I'm pausing to demonstrate it. I'm also pausing to let that sink in. Silence is the exclusive territory of the powerful. There's an old proverb. It may be Chinese, it may not. There's an old proverb that speaks to negotiation. And don't kid yourself, 97% of your conversations are negotiation-based. And also keep in mind that 86.245% of all statistics are fabricated, most of the time by the person delivering them. When you're in negotiation, the proverb is this: he or she who speaks first loses. He or she that speaks first loses. What great instruction about the subtlety and the power that's behind that, which means maybe you should be more quiet. I was on the phone with someone earlier, and they said, I asked this question, and then I was silent. What a beautiful wording for that. What a musical phrase that is. And again, the connection between language and music, it just continues to show up. Phrasing, pacing, cadence, emotion, all that stuff. He said, I was silent. And that is an embodiment. That is us inhabiting silence instead of trying to create it or leverage it. So, at this stage of the conversation, I'd like to make an offer to everyone that's listening. You're going to see a link show up in the chat where you, should you decide, you will be able to get me to mail you a copy of my list of 10 aspirations for every day. I've been handing this card out for 11 years now, and I've seen photos of it on people's computer monitors. I've seen it on dashboards of cars. I've seen it in bathroom mirrors. And to me, it's a great reminder of setting the frame for the day, of composing in advance how I want to think about my day. And it is called Every Day, and it's 10 aspirations. And Amanda, if you would throw that link up there so that people can see it and go to it once we're done, or when they listen to this later, or at their leisure, anyone that goes to the link and fills out the contact form on our website and gives us their mailing address, I will handwrite a note and I will mail you this card that has these 10 aspirations. And just so you have an idea of what they are, one of them is to pray, meditate, or be silent. Every single day, it is absolutely critical that we make the selection to inhabit one of those concepts, to meditate, to pray, or to simply be silent. I bring this up for a couple of different reasons, because the hardest thing on earth to master is ourselves. And the most rewarding thing on earth to master is ourselves. And mastery, to me, when I hear that word, it always and immediately reminds me of a quote that I heard from an author of these large epic novels. The author's name was James Michener. And I didn't realize I had accidentally advanced that. James Michener was asked, when did you realize that you had mastered the art of writing novels? And his immediate response was, I'm not interested in that. The person interviewing him was intuitive and said, well, what are you interested in mastering? And he said, I'm interested in mastering the art of living. And the interviewer said, what does that mean? And this is what he responded with. The master in the art of living makes no distinction between his work and his play, his labor and his leisure, his education and his recreation, his mind and his body, his love and his religion. He hardly knows which is which. He simply pursues his vision of excellence in whatever he does, leaving it for others to decide whether he is at work or at play. Because to him, he's always doing both. He's always doing both. Forgive me for pausing on that. I've quoted that about 1,100 times, and I still get choked up saying it, because when I read it, when I think about it, it reminds me of this endless pursuit of mastery and how along the way we start to experience things that change our condition. that build a compelling future between us and other people. And that's what this is all about. And what it really boils down to is what you see on the slide now. To me, connecting, communicating, deeper dialogue, conversations that inspire, they are not about what it is that you say. It's about what you can find out. It's about asking questions that engage and involve the other person. It's about the key pursuit in being able to connect with other humans is curiosity. How did you do that? What led you to that? What are you hoping to achieve? How was that idea, that experience, that place to go, that pursuit, how was that introduced to you? And the stunning alchemy of solid language is that when I ask a question that is about the other person and their future, all of a sudden, after a while, I become invisible. Conversations are not about how much you can say. Conversations are, in my mind, about what you can find out. This is about how the mind works. And the mind is a limitless tool. It is the analogy I give is the difference between a hard drive on a small computer and the cloud. The brain is the hard drive. It is a limited entity. It is housed in the cranium, and it's only going to get so big. What is limitless is the mind, because Napoleon Hill taught us whatever the mind can conceive and believe, it will achieve. And deeper dialogue is all about you tapping into the power of your mind. It's all about tapping into the power of your mind as opposed to you using your brain more. Now, one of the things that we have found in our studies is that whenever we endeavor to learn something new, we're making the brain healthier because it is building, it is connecting synapses that weren't connected before. And studies have shown that people into their 80s, as long as they are learning something new, will continue to build and grow new neural pathways. And that's exciting. That to me is kind of wonderful. Single most common word in the English language is I. And the more you use the word I to begin sentences, the less your listener is interested. This simple diagram that you see in front of you can change within 4 days, can change how everyone around you interacts with you, can change what you accomplish, can redefine your future if you can limit the amount of times you begin your sentences with I and start to incorporate beginning sentences with you, we, or us. When we think about the word I, here's the rule of thumb. The third time you begin a sentence with the word I, your listener or your reader has mentally checked out. I challenge everyone on this call to open up the last 3 emails that you composed and count how many sentences begin with I. Here's the thing to remember. Writing is done for the reader, not for the writer. If you're going to write something and 5 sentences out of 8 begin with I, you are venting. You're not communicating. This is a leadership tool. This is a sales tool. This is a relationship tool. When you can replace I with you, we, or us, you change the dynamic and you get closer to finding a way to connect. And folks, that's what this is all about. Deeper dialogue is about finding ways to connect, ways to deepen the connections that we have with other people, and to ultimately move conversations forward. So Amanda, you had asked if we would open up for questions near the end. What a great time for those.
Fantastic. So go ahead and enter in the chat or Q&A feature any questions that you have. Comments, I did go ahead and post in the chat the link to get that freebie information. So please take a look there, and you should be able to click on the link and then take you to fill out the contact information. So, John, tell us a little bit, as we're waiting for people to come up with some ideas or questions that they have, if you have any really great takeaways that you would like to say, here's two or three things that I'd like for you to take out of today's session or put forward in your next conversations. Do you have anything you'd like to kind of close out with?
Sure. I'm looking at my notes, and one thing that I did not address that I did not have a slide for when I was doing my preparation for our session today. And by the way, I want to thank TRICOM for sponsoring this, for inviting me to do this. I want to thank Amanda for all the work that she put in behind the scenes. I have made this as difficult for her as I possibly could, and she found a way to come out smiling. So God bless you for that. What is in my notes that was not part of the conversation was the difference between perception and intent. Many of us have heard the words or said the words, but that's not what I meant. Well, that means that you did not take the time to craft better language. It is not the listener's fault that they did not perceive what you intended. There's a huge chasm between perception and intent. So it is critical that we ensure that when we're delivering language, whether asking questions or making declarative statements, that we craft that language in a way where we feel confident that the perception will be in alignment with our intent. How's that?
Great. Thank you. One question as it relates to where there's a conflict in maybe a communication. Do you have any suggestions on how to turn around a conversation that turned into a conflict where it wasn't expected?
Well, conflict is part of the human experience. What is critical is how we deal with that conflict and how we resolve that conflict, or whether we choose to resolve that conflict. Because when we know that when all of a sudden we're hit with something we had not expected, we tend to respond emotionally. You mentioned, you were kind enough to mention my podcast. When we launched our podcast, it was specifically, in my mind, focused on the startup world. So we called it Your Startup Advisors. Well, after I did 30 interviews, I realized that the content and what we were talking about was applicable to a lot more people because of the folks that we attracted as interview guests. And one of them was a gentleman named Dwayne Samuels, and Dwayne invented something called Simple Logic. And it is a combination of artificial intelligence and video, where he has figured out how to read micro expressions through his artificial intelligence, to read micro expressions to identify the level of truth that people are using to express themselves. And what he told me was, we are not thinking individuals who feel. We are wildly emotional beings who also happen to think. So if we can not control our emotions, because I think that's a tall order. If we can keep our emotions in check and look to understand before we debate, then we may be able to resolve conflict in a healthy way. Some conflicts we're not going to be able to resolve. It's a fact of life. We have, but the more we are interested in us in pushing our agenda, the less adept we will be at resolving conflict. And another piece of wisdom that was given to me by one of my mentors some years ago is, you have two choices. You can be right, or you can get what you want. You never even asked the question, so what do you want to do? He just made that statement, which spoke to me.
Mm-hmm.
All right,
absolutely.
I'm not seeing any questions, are you?
Some questions can come directly to me, so that was the only question that I had come in. Do we have any, if anyone has any other questions, go ahead and submit them. I would, highly recommend taking a look at John's podcast. Certainly, we can definitely learn some more information from that series. Did you have any final thoughts that you'd like to share before we wrap up today's session, if there are no other questions?
I wasn't sure if I gave the name of the podcast. It's called Your Startup Advisors. It's very easy to find on iHeartRadio.com. If you look in podcasts and type in Your Startup Advisors, there are over 100 episodes. I had a Shark Tank winner on. I had the director of investment from HP. I had folks that have invented companies that have turned into something really, really interesting. And unless there's another question, Amanda, I feel very privileged to have had this platform to speak with your audience.
This is great. Well, thank you. And, you know, for anyone that's interested in the audiobook, Deeper Dialogue, Conversations That Inspire, thank you again for taking the time out of your day to join us on today's webinar. John, thank you for sharing this information. We will have a recording available on our website for anyone who missed the session or would like to share it with others within their organization or within their circle of friends. Thank you again, and just watch for additional information on our next webinar session. I hope you have a fantastic day. Thanks for joining us.